Hello, my name is Daniel Stephenson. I'm a weed scientist at the LSU Ag Center. I'm domiciled at the Dingley Research and Extension Center in Alexandria. And today I want to talk about a very common pest in Louisiana. Unfortunately, when I arrived here in 2008, there was not a lot of palmer amaranth. As you see behind me, as you can pan right here, you'll see a little bit closer of this particular pest. And over time, it has grown significantly. They first found this weed that was resistant to glyphosate. Most folks know that as Roundup and other trade names. In Georgia, back middle of early 05, I think, somewhere 04, 05 in that area. And then a couple years later, it was just found in Tennessee and Arkansas, Mississippi. And we followed course. We documented glyphosate-resistant palmer amaranth in Louisiana in 2010. And since that time, it is spread through the majority of the corn, cotton, soybean areas of Louisiana. So this is palmer amaranth. You will have a separate male and female plant. We don't have any inflorescence here. Maybe we can show that a little bit later. But the males have a lot of spines on them. The females have spines on them and the males are very soft. So one produces seed, the other one produces the pollen. And resistance can travel in the pollen. Research has shown that it can go as by 600 meters, which is approximately 600 yards, that this pollen. So in other words, if your neighbor has a lot of glyphosate-resistant palmer amaranth in their farm, but you don't, that doesn't mean that you can't get it. Because if you allow one female to pass and that male pollinates that female, you could very well have a problem. So today we're going to talk about how to chop a pigweed, because not all herbicide programs can control it, particularly when they're this big. Even the newer technologies, the dicamba and the 2,4-D tolerant technologies, it's not going to kill something this big. It'll fold it over, but it's just not going to do a good job. So we have to send out chopping crews, or I hope you do, because don't call me and say, what can I spray on something this big? Because I'm going to say, I'm sorry, this is your best friend, still. So in hoeing this weed, what a lot of people will do is they'll hire a crew and they'll walk through the field and they'll just cut it. Okay? And say, well, I got some on there, so I just cut it. That weed can grow back. Come here and focus in on this. See, I left that root right there? I didn't cut it down below the soil surface. The proper way to chop that weed is to actually take your hoe and get down. Now that weed will not come back. So you'll see chopping crews. If they're walking fast, and I'm going to demonstrate. They're walking fast through a field, and it don't matter if it's cotton or if it's soybeans. If you see them holding this hoe like this, just doing stuff like that, and they keep walking, you're wasting your money. Because they're not killing that plant. Look at all that material that's left there. Mark, you'll come here and get a close-up. Look at all this material. We cannot hoe a pigweed and expect it to die this size. You've got to get underneath it. Notice that. Really get down on it to chop it out. That's the way. See how low that one is? Little root right there. You can see I'm scraping around it with my hoe. You have to get down below the soil surface to chop it. Now another thing guys did say, well, I'm gonna pull it. Number one, if a weed is this big, pretty hard to pull. I got a big old butt, so I'm gonna do my best to pull it. So now, this one's probably better. Look at the root ball on this. All that dirt that's around it. If I simply go, do you know what this plant right here is going to do? It's going to re-root. These roots are going to go back down in the soil. You got this dirt ball around it. It's going to re-root. And you'd come back and you'd see it doing one of these later in life. So when you pull them, take that dirt, shake that dirt off of it, get that root ball necking, turn it upside down, let it dry, take it out of the field, let it dry. Even if you bundle them up with dirt on them, you take them out into the field, they'll still re-root. friend of mine and weed scientist in Tennessee told a story about a grower did that. The weeds rerooted on the end of the field and emerged, still produced seed, didn't emerge. They began to regrow, produce seed, and you can see where the seed from the rain washed it out into the field. So, if we're going to pull them, you got to do this. If you're going to chop them, you got to get mad at them. That is the way. If we're going to use steel to combat Palmer amaranth, this is the way it's got to be done. One of the things that our growers in Louisiana need to think about is not just weed control out in the field. That's kind of self-explanatory. You don't want any weeds in your field, but it's on the edge of your field that we really need to think about. This is glyphosate-resistant Palmer amaranth. And this particular female I'm holding right here could potentially produce well over 1 million seed. And the seed are about the size of a ball and a ballpoint pen. And let's see if there's any yet. There it goes. Little black dots. That's viable seed. So in other words, this particular female Palmer amaranth is ready to drop viable seed to come up next year or even later this year. So whether it's Palmer amaranth here, any kind of smell melons, which I know is a significant problem for a lot of my growers south of here, or any kind of grass species that you'll have, brown top millet, horse purslane, do something with the edge of these fields. Because when you come around with your combine and you're gonna drive into these 4, 8, 12 rows, and your man drops his header and goes through this, guess what you're doing? You're just taking those little bitty seed that we just saw earlier, those little black dots, and spreading them through the field. So think about this on the end, because this can infest you later down the road. Let's talk about the difference between male and female Palmer amaranths. They're separate plants. They're called dioecious. And this is a male here. This is a female. Notice the difference. The spines here that are on the female is kind of sharp. The males are not. So the female are sticky witches. And males are soft and cuddly. That's the way you can tell them apart. So, keep this in mind as you're going through the area. Just because you've got all males doesn't mean you don't have a problem. This produces pollen, and that pollen can confer or transfer resistance to a female plant that may be susceptible. So now we know the difference between female Palmer amaranth, male Palmer amaranth. We got to understand, guys, that we cannot allow this to happen, or we're just going to continue to perpetuate the problem of this weed. I want to take this opportunity to thank the growers of Louisiana. Very big supporters of the LSU Ag Center, just not myself in weed science, but our entomologist and plant pathologist, all the way through our 4-H and FCS agents. So on behalf of my fellow LSU Ag Center people, I want to tell you thank you. Also want to tell thank you to the Louisiana Soybean and Feed Grain Promotion Board. Without their funding, I would not be able to conduct the research that I do, to deliver the information to the Louisiana grower, to help them hopefully make as much money as they can, because that's my goal, to help and advise that grower so they can put as many nickels, dollars, dimes back in their pocket as they can. I also want to tell you guys that if you got any questions, please call. I have a theory, and it's called there's no such thing as a dumb question. Contact your local county agent. They can call me, and that's a really good source and a way to go through things, because if your agent in your parish knows that you have a problem, they can be there with you, and 9 times out of 10 they can answer your question, and they're great because we got some good agents. If they need to bring me in, they give me a call and I'll come in. So please don't ever hesitate to call us, because there's no such thing as a dumb question. Thank you again.